Keep us company.
Linda, can you hear us?
Yeah, I can hear you. I just, I have COVID.
Oh, you have COVID?
Don't talk much. Yeah, I got COVID.
Oh, no.
You too? Oh, yeah, I just came back from Costa Rica. My sister-in-law's 2 days ahead of me.
Linda, oh, I'm in the same boat.
Oh, my goodness.
Golly, thanks, right? I'm so sorry.
Damn.
That's okay. I look like death warmed over. Speaking of which, can you guys pray for my mom? The facility just called, and she's now taking a turn for the worse and not present and not eating and not getting up, and it's bad, and I can't be there. So I'm really upset about that, but I can't contaminate them either.
No, sorry, Linda. Keep your family
first. Yeah. Did somebody else say they had COVID beside Linda and I?
I heard John.
Oh, John didn't have. John doesn't have COVID, I don't think.
No.
Oh, okay. That's what I heard. Sorry.
No.
I have COVID ears, I guess.
Yeah, I do too.
Yeah. And I'm tired. Well, Linda, oh, my goodness.
Linda, I got right on Paxlovid, and it really kicks it out of the water. I still have to do everything, but I feel better. I'm still a little. I mean, I'm on day two, but.
Oh, I'm on day four.
Oh, you're doing good. You're a little ahead of me.
Yeah, day four.
What's funny is that here we are getting COVID, and yet I've been inside my house and not going out because of the weather.
Morning. The Lord be with you. It is good to be in the church this morning. Wonderful to be back. However, I just want to say to those online, it was great joining you as well last Sunday. And what a blessing to be together even in that way. So, we come before God, thanking God for God's presence and God's love. There are a number of things we want to share with you this morning. In particular, I want to say that we are having a special service for the Poor People's Campaign, and we are excited about it, and we trust you will find it a blessing as well as a challenge and an inspiration. I would ask Jenny to come forward. Oh, wait a second, one more thing. I want you to know that there are some materials on the back table from the Poor People's Campaign. We would love it if you would pick one up and go to those sites on the paper. So let us continue.
Good morning.
Good morning.
So not only is this week a very full, exciting service, we have several other opportunities coming up. So on the back table and on the website, which for those of you who used the website last week to begin to get on Zoom, it has changed during this week. So this page is our home page. It's not going to stay this way. It has a little glitch in it that I'm trying to fix. But you can click where it says join in for worship Zoom. That's our Zoom link to be able to get in anytime. Across the top, if you click on ministries and missions and go to the drop down menu that says our ministries, you can scroll through all of the items that we have offered there. Isn't that wonderful? So the one that I particularly want to pull your attention to is the one that says small group dinners. You can click on where it says sign up. If you are interested, if you already signed up, there's an addition that we did to this. So go ahead and sign up again. Doesn't matter if you don't sign up again, we still got you, we'll still include you, but there's a little addition to it. So it will take you to a Google form that will ask you, yes? Okay, and the sign-up link is not showing? Well, thank you. I'll contact the tech person. Hello, self. And we'll get right on that. tomorrow. Yeah, you just click on the highlighted sign up. Well, I'm glad. Thank you for letting us know that. So the part that says sign up, it has the link there, or you can just click on the picture and it will take you to a Google form where you can fill out your name, your address, email address, and then it has a question about if you are willing to host or not, and then how you would like us to contact you to let you know what group you're part of. So, promised Pastor Dave that I would be very fast at that. So, check out our website during this week. Let us know. There are things that are definitely going to change. There are parts that aren't open yet, but it's a work in progress here. Also wanted to let you know there's a sign up in the back for our congregational meeting potluck, which is on February 4th. So, thank you, and enjoy. Darcy.
Thank you, Jenny, and thank you and Brian for all your work on that. We also want you to know that we're here. I don't know what I was going to say. So, that being the case, the peace of Christ be with you.
Peace of Christ be with you, all of you.
Peace of Christ to all of you, and hopefully good health.
In your own.
So
yes.
After I finish the call to worship,
yes.
Then I'm supposed to sit up here.
That would be great. Yes, for the scripture. That would be perfect, Marilyn. Thank you.
So our gathering hymn, I think that's what it's called, is actually number 70. What does the Lord require?
Please join me in the call to worship. We are called to heal a world that is hurting.
Here we are, Lord, send us.
We are called to speak truth to power.
Here we are, Lord, send us.
We are called to bring your transformative and everlasting justice to all. Our opening hymn is number 100, Canticle of the Turning.
Darcy would like to share with you during our time for children. And I want to say what I remember, what I forgot earlier, and that is that the liturgy today is provided by the Poor People's Campaign, and Darcy was instrumental in getting that to us, so we appreciate that.
Well, I'm finding my document so that I'm actually saying what I'm supposed to say for children's sermon, but before I do that, I would like to, on behalf of the coordinating committee of the Washington Poor People's Campaign, express our deepest joy and appreciation for your willingness to step up and be our very first faith partner when we got started in 2021. So for all the children that are among us, a little history on the Poor People's Campaign, and so fighting for what we believe in together. So in 2018, a 56-year-old black disciples minister, Reverend Dr. William Barber II, joined with a Presbyterian USA pastor named Reverend Dr. Liz Theo Harris. And that came about from the original campaign, which started in 1968. This was the new Poor People's Campaign, and the purpose is to bring people together across all different walks of life so that we can be one band, one sound. And so Jubilee is a word that's used a lot in the Poor People's Campaign, and some of you are like, well, what is Jubilee? Jubilee is a movement of faith rooted in the Bible. Today, the Poor People's Campaign Jubilee calls for radical faith-based reform and reparation for our nation's horrific history of racism, systemic racism, inequality, and violence, which more than half of our nation's children, 38.5 million, do not know if they will have a place to sleep, nutritious meals, or safe communities. And so then the first principle is everybody deserves to have what they need, not just to survive, but thrive. And so that's what our campaign is built on. And so, you know, it makes God sad when people don't have what they need, and God loves them and God loves you. And so out of that belovedness, or that deep, rich love that God has for you, that's why God calls us to make sure that we provide those same things that we have for everybody, so that everybody has what they need. So join me in a quick word of prayer here. Holy Parent, break our hearts for what breaks yours. Help us truly hear the calls for help and urge us to respond. Break our hearts of stone and give us hearts of compassion. Use our hands to bind the wounds of a world crying out in need of healing. Amen.
So we know that in many ways we are complicit in those things that harm others, that oppress others, that stringently keep folks from being and doing what they are able to do and what we are able to provide. So it is appropriate that as we come to worship, we confess our sins before God, knowing that God hears us, loves us, and forgives us. Let us pray together as printed in our bulletins. We confess
that we are always without our fault, creating injustice to the world in need. We often forgive us on who deserves to receive. Remind us, O Holy Parent, that when we say, bring my justice, O
We have been washed clean once again by God's healing and transformative love. Go out and share the gospel whose power heals, calls, leads, and helps us from all walks of life and breaks down divisions. Let the healing power of that good news be the cornerstone of our work toward justice. We declare Jubilee. We are forgiven. Amen.
Please pray with me. Holy Parent, help us to listen to your voice amid the cacophony of voices that turn us away from you. Remove the scales from our eyes and help us see wounds that need binding. Remind us to seek the sacred among the ordinary, and remind us that you are in all. Open our ears and hearts to hear the cries of a world in pain. Break our hearts of stone and stir us to act radically to bring your transformative and restorative justice to life. Amen. The Old Testament reading is Deuteronomy chapter 26, verses 5 through 13. Then you shall declare before the Lord your God, "My father was a wandering Aramean, and he went down into Egypt with a few people and lived there and became a great nation, powerful and numerous. But the Egyptians mistreated us and made us suffer, subjecting us to harsh labor. Then we cried out to the Lord, the God of our ancestors, and the Lord heard our voice and saw our misery, toil, and oppression. So the Lord brought us out of Egypt with a mighty hand and an outstretched arm, with great terror and with signs and wonders. He brought us to this place and gave us this land, a land flowing with milk and honey. And now I bring the first fruits of the soil that you, Lord, have given me. Place the basket before the Lord your God and bow down before him. Then you and the Levites and the foreigners residing among you shall rejoice in all the good things the Lord your God has given to you and your household. When you have finished setting aside a tenth of all your produce in the third year, the year of the tithe, you shall give it to the Levite, the foreigner, the fatherless, and the widow, so that they may eat in your towns and be satisfied. Then say to the Lord your God, I have removed from my house the sacred portion and have given it to the Levite, the foreigner, the fatherless, and the widow, according to all you commanded. I have not turned aside from your commands, nor have I forgotten any of them. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Matthew 25, verses 35 to 41. Listen again for God's word. Jesus says, the king says, "For I was hungry, and you gave me food. I was thirsty, and you gave me something to drink. I was a king, and you welcomed me. I was naked, and you gave me clothing. I was sick, and you took care of me. I was in prison, and you visited me." Then the righteous will answer him, "Lord, when was it that we saw you hungry and gave you food, or thirsty and gave you something to drink? And when was it that we saw you a stranger and welcomed you, or naked and gave you clothing? And when was it that we saw you sick or in prison and visited you? And the king will answer them, truly I tell you, just as you did it to one of the least of these brothers and sisters of mine, you did it to me. Then he will say to those at his left hand, you who are accursed, depart from me into the eternal fire prepared for the devil and his angels. This is the word of the Lord. It is our privilege and pleasure to have folks share with you the way God has moved in their lives and what they see as so essential for us and for the world. Darcy.
I'm part of the Poor People's Campaign, a national call for moral revival, because I am called as a person of faith, shepherd, and deacon to speak truth to power, work tirelessly and collaboratively to help break the chains of injustice, and let God's justice roll down as a mighty stream. The Poor People's Campaign calls those in power to turn away from life-destroying ways that cause harm and instead turn towards life-giving ways that heal and provide for all. I am called to be the voice in the wilderness, following the legacy of those prophetic voices who came before me, calling for those in power to turn away from ways of violence and scarcity, and instead to turn towards ways of peace and generosity. Swords shall one day be beaten into plowshares and transformed from instruments of harm into instruments of healing. Unity will be restored. And we will learn to speak with one voice, the voice of the whole human family. The interlocking evils can be overwhelming, but the fusion organizing, collaboration, and inclusion that both the Washington Poor People's Campaign and Poor People's Campaign provide are a perfect counter to the world's message of one person cannot make a difference. I may not be able to make a difference alone, but if I become a co-conspirator and join with others in my community, together we can bring about the radical, restorative, and transformative justice that God is pleading and urging us to bring to life here in the Lower Columbia region, Washington State, nationally, and globally. Somebody's hurting our family, and it's gone on far too long, and I won't be silent anymore.
I'm going to share a few things from the Poor People Campaign website that will kind of refresh our memories on what they declare on that, if I may. And hold on, let me just get this up. In 1968, Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King and many others called for a revolution of values in America. They sought to build a broad fusion movement that could unite poor and impacted communities across the country. Their name was a direct cry from the underside of history, the Poor People's Campaign. Today, the Poor People's Campaign, a national call for moral revival, has picked up this unfinished work. From Alaska to Arkansas, the Bronx to the border, people are coming together to confront the interlocking evils of systemic racism, poverty, ecological devastation, militarism, and the war economy, and the distorted moral narrative of religious nationalism. We understand that as a nation, we are at a critical juncture, that we need a movement that will shift the moral narrative, impact policies and elections at every level of government, and build lasting power for poor and impacted communities. It goes much further. I would recommend go to that website and read it because it is very enlightening. Some of their principles. We are rooted in the moral analysis based on our deepest religious and constitutional values that demand justice for all. Moral revival is necessary to save the heart and soul of our democracy. Their principles are wonderful, and it's just foundational, true, wonderful stuff. I think the verse from Matthew that we heard a minute ago is so apt when we talk about this, that truly I tell you, whatever you did for the least of these brothers and sisters of mine, you did for me. You can't misinterpret that verse. It's impossible to misinterpret that verse. When Darcy and Pastor Dave asked me to speak this Sunday about the Poor People's Campaign, I was reluctant because I didn't feel worthy. I really don't think I do enough. But after reading and really digging into what the Poor People Campaign is about, I realized that it is truly something that I advocate for as a person and as a Christian and as a deacon. And sometimes we wonder what we should be doing as a Poor People Campaign church and as Christians. And I think the principles stated for the Poor People's Campaign paints a pretty clear path. This is a big part of our Christian identity. We advocate for the least among us. We show up in one way or another. When we see inequity or injustice, whether it be a prayer or showing up and speaking up when and where we might be able to make a difference, both are important exercises of our faith. Both represent the Poor People's Campaign. It is said, 'tis better to give than to receive, but I think we'd all argue that they are the same. To give, to be able to give, is to receive blessings beyond anything else we can experience. Thank you.
Well, I can tell that I'm the old person up here at the mic today. Everybody else is using some kind of electronic device to read. I'm using paper. Ever since I was a little kid, I have been passionate about serving vulnerable people. I remember at age 4 asking my mother, "But Mom, what about the Indians?" Now, we lived in Indiana. There were no Native Americans there. But this passion about serving vulnerable people has continued in adulthood and has led me to embrace Matthew 25. And Lord, when did we feed you? And when did we clothe you? When would we house you? When you do these things to the least of your brethren, you do them to me. With this passion a constant in my life, it just seems a given that I would also embrace the tenets of the Poor People's Campaign. And I have 5 tenets written down that I copied off their website. We rise to demand that the 140 million poor and low-income people in our nation, from every race, creed, color, sexuality, and place, are no longer ignored, dismissed, or pushed to the margins of our political and social agenda. We rise not as left or right, Democrat or Republican, but as a moral fusion movement to build power, build moral activism, build voter participation, and we won't be silent anymore. We rise to change the moral narrative and demand that the interlocking injustices of systematic racism, poverty, ecological devastation, the war, economy, militarism, and the distorted moral narrative of religious nationalism all be ended. We rise to challenge the lie of scarcity in the midst of abundance. We rise to lift the voices and faces of the poor and low-income Americans and their moral allies with a new vision of love, justice, and truth for America that says poverty can be abolished and change can come. These tenets show me how to follow the path outlined in Micah 6:8. And what does the Lord require of you? To do justice, love mercy, and walk humbly with your God.
I am Matthew 25. No, I haven't wrote anything down. I'm the old person with anything, and everything's in the mind. I do everything by the Spirit. You don't know what it's like to be poor. You don't know what it's like to live in poverty. You don't know what it's like to worry when you go to bed and not knowing whether you're going to have food to feed yourself or your children. You don't understand what it's like to have the injustice to any culture of the world, the diversity, whoever you are and whatever you are and wherever you live. I am Matthew 25. I believe in giving and helping and making sure everybody has got something to eat. I worry about children of the world. I am the voice. I will be the voice. And every one of you in here should be the voice for justice, to fight, to make sure that people of America have food, the bills are paid, the kids have something to eat in school, at home, wherever. I am Matthew 25. I keep saying that, and I want you to hear it. Everything before me, all of you that have spoke for me, have not walked and lived in my skin or my shoes. I do feed and help people that have less than me. I don't have much, but I give. Because God said, feed my people. He was on a mountaintop when hundreds and hundreds of people came to hear him. He had nothing, but there was somebody with fish and bread. And what did he do? He multiplied it. And he fed 5,000 or more. And that's what this church does. That's what this community does. And that's what Cynthia does. So remember anything, Matthew 25. Think it, feel it, understand it, believe it. And if you can, help someone feel better about themselves. Amen.
Thank you all. Your voices share with us something very important, significant, and powerful to hear. I have a whole sermon written for today. I just couldn't resist doing so. But the voices you've already heard, the message already exclaimed, is something that I believe is significant and inspires us. Thank you all for sharing us this morning. But I want to share just one more voice, one more thing to what you've already heard. I want to talk about the spiritual presence of God in the midst of a hurting people, a hurting nation, and a hurting world, as you've just been expressed. I want to say in specific what we each are instructed and empowered to do. We are first and foremost to pray, and our prayers are specific and necessary. First, even as we did this morning, we are to repent. We are to confess our sins. We are to acknowledge that we are a part of this community. We are a part of our nation that so often oppresses and keeps people in poverty. That is what is expressed in the Poor People's Campaign. That's what you'll see when you look up what it's all about and what has been shared. So we are to confess and repent before God. our involvement and participation in many of the hurts and struggles of the people today. Second of all, and I believe even more important and even more crucial, is to lament, to share with God our sorrows and our hurts and our difficulties that we face in this time as always. That we do indeed respond to God and say, God, listen to us. This world is so sinful. This world is so hurtful. This world is so full of destruction and violence, not only across the borders, but in our own nation as well, in our own communities as well, and sometimes even in our own families as well. So we are to cry out to God. Did you hear the Deuteronomy passage? Did you hear what was said there? It was said that the people were enslaved. They were oppressed. They were abused. That they were in dire straits. And what did they do? They cried out to God. They expressed from their gut the hurts and the anguish that they faced. And they cried out to God. We are to cry out to God for those things we see every day. Those people we pass on the road that are struggling and have no place to go. Those people that are hurting and struggling in this world. Cry out to God. Why? Because God hears us. Just as he heard the people of Israel, he hears us as well. And I believe, as we've already heard, that our efforts and our deeds and our commitment are listened to by God. God sees. And I believe God is going to respond and does respond in ways surprising us, in ways astounding us, in ways that help us to rejoice and be thankful. I suspect all of you had a warm and dry place the last few days. It was intensely cold. It was bitter cold, and it was slippery, and it was slick, and there was sliding going on. And I was thankful for that warmth and that drying. But I know there were those for whom that wasn't the case. There were those, for some reasons, not able to go into the day centers, which were open, thankfully, but aren't able to participate in that because of issues, perhaps having dogs or being on illegal drugs or struggling mental issues. There may have been excluded, and I suspect were. This world is a tough place. This world is a hard place. But we are in this world. And the third and last thing I'd like to share is that we are to protest. We are to raise our voices. We are to take steps. And I'm so grateful that we are a church, as you heard, that welcomes those, welcomes everyone who comes in that door. Can I share one more thing? Can I share one more experience that I had? I was a part of a church mission and a part of a ministry, as I've shared before, for disabilities. And I was involved in having people that were outside and excluded come in and participate and worship with us. And I was with a church that had responded, and I applaud them, and I commend them, and I'm astounded by them because they bought a house. They bought a house and they turned it into a day center for those who were homeless. And they had showers and they had laundry facilities. And they welcomed people. They had from 5 to 30 folks that participated at one time in finding a safe, warm, dry place. I went to the church and I was so impressed with that ministry. But I went to the church because they invited me to talk about those who were disabled with a group of folks that were interested. And I went to worship there. And I sat in the back pew beside a gentleman who was disheveled, who was unbathed, who was struggling. And I shared niceties with him and was glad to see him. And we prayed together before service. We were closing our eyes and lifting our hearts before God. And then he fell asleep. He fell asleep and he lied down on the pew. And he was beginning to snore. And the gentleman who ran the homeless center did something that astounded me. He went and he woke him up and he said, and I don't remember his name, but he called him by name and he said, "Come with me," and he escorted him out of the sanctuary, out of the church. I found that unbelievable. I found that hard to reckon and reconcile, because those are the very folks who are invited by God. Those are the very folks we share our love, compassion, and appreciation. We are different, and we are worked to be different because we know that saving grace of Christ. We know that love of Christ. We know that acceptance of Christ. Amen.
This song that we're about to learn is a song that's entitled "Somebody's Hurting My Brother." Now, this song was actually born in a town hall meeting around coal ash. And the meeting came about because Duke Energy was spilling coal ash into poor black and brown and poor white neighborhoods. After hearing testimony after testimony of people who were impacted physically and mentally by the coal ash, this song came as an inspiration of those testimonies. So I'll call to you, "Somebody's Hurting My Brother," and it's gone on, and your response is, "Far too long." Yes, it's gone on.
Far too long.
It's gone on.
Far too long.
"Somebody's Hurting My Brother," and it's gone on.
Far too long.
Now the end is, "And we won't be silent anymore." We'll say that together.
And we won't be silent anymore.
Okay? And so we'll try the rehearsal version, which goes, "Oh, somebody's hurting my brother, and it's gone on
far too long.
Yes, it's gone on
far too long.
I tell you, it's gone on
far too long.
Oh, somebody's hurting my brother, and it's gone on
far too long.
Together,
and we won't be silent anymore."
Now, we're going to put a little rhythm to this, okay? We're going to speed up just a little bit. Not too fast.
Hi.
Let us bring our prayers before God this morning. Let us join together, and if you have something on your heart you'd like to share, I invite you to do so.
I'm Alan. Good morning. I would appreciate more prayers for the gentleman I found in the cold during that cold snap, and his name is Scott. I don't know what his last name is, but I feel like he felt my love, and he felt like he mattered, and in the end I made him promise that he would find shelter during that, but I would just appreciate continued prayers for Scott.
God, in your grace,
I have a few things I'm going to share since Jan's going to make me walk to the other side of the room. Yesterday, the Gillespies and Gabriel and Kristen and Ron and I took part in a One Parish, One Prisoner mini conference in Olympia. It was really nice to hear some of the stories and share some with teams around from Tacoma and actually Everett and Port Angeles and down to here. But one thing I want to mention that came up was one of the participants mentioned that their released friend participating in their church is part of what they call the Angels in the Loft. The Angels in the Loft are the folks who run the audiovisual at that church. So I raise up the Angels in our back table every week. And I also want to mention, because I noticed it again this morning when I came in, and maybe some of the rest of you noticed, I think I'm right from an email that I saw from Dave. There's a big box, one of those, whatever they call it, load on the trains and carry materials that sits out where our neighbors, Chuck and Kat and Don, lived for several months. And that box is a sign. It's a sign that something's happening back there. It is a step for Sunrise Village.
God, in your grace.
I'm Jan, and I'm asking prayers for my mom. She has cataract surgery on Wednesday for the first one, and then she goes back a week later. So just prayers that it goes well, and she's able to see, and she can sew easier.
God, in your grace.
Hi, this is Joe. I'm an old protester from the 60s, from Dr. King, and into the 70s. And Darcy, I need to tell you that today has restored and revived my passion to protest.
God, in your grace.
My name is Sharon. I just wanted to share a couple of cold weather stories. Because Joe posted something about the number of homeless people in our community didn't equate to the number that were currently being sheltered at the church or with the little houses, and there were still people in the streets, I wrote back and said, would it be a good idea to call the police and ask them to look for people? It was that really cold night when the ice was coming down. And she said, it's worth a try. So I called, and the dispatcher put me through rather quickly to a gentleman who was on the night shift in the patrol car. He called within 2 minutes, and he said, when I told him my concern about people that may not have found a place to go, he said, that's what I will do tonight. I will look for people, and if I find them, I will try to find them a place where they can go. And I think sometimes we don't appreciate enough the simple things that people do to be helpful. And so thanks to that officer, and thanks to this group of people today who organized our service and raised our consciousness and our awareness. Thank you.
God, in your grace.
I would just like to uplift again the people of Gaza. This morning on the news, there was a brief story about a 13-year-old boy whose father, they don't know where he is. His mother was killed on October 13th. And since then, he has been parenting his six younger siblings, going into the village, whatever was left of it, to find water and food for them each day. One of those siblings is a six-month-old baby who they showed him bottle feeding and rocking, trying to get to keep quiet. And he just, very emotionless, went from this place to that to get something and come back. And stories like that happen so often, I'm not usually affected by them. But this was a horrific thing to hear about. And so pray for him and his family and those who are still at war over in Gaza, and on both Israel and the Gaza side.
God, in your grace.
Good morning. My name is Julie, and I'm asking for prayers of healing for Pastor Linda Beatty. She has COVID and is feeling poorly, so prayers for her quick recovery.
God, in your grace.
And Robert does as well.
God, in your grace.
And while Ron's making his way back over to that corner, we have a couple of prayers from Zoom. So Linda is dealing with COVID right now, and her mother also has taken a turn for the worse this morning, and of course she can't be there. So just prayers for Alvina's peaceful passing for both of them. And then Daryl's also reached out. Krista had a 10-hour surgical procedure on Thursday. All three surgeons were able to do their part and remove the cancer and do the HIPEC procedure. So she still has a lot of pain and will be in the hospital for about 7 days. So just continued prayers. But that was one of the big scary things, and it looks like it went as well as it could. And so thank you guys for your continued prayers and support.
God, in your grace.
Judy, our son is still without a job, and every day Jim and I are, you know, being that woman who went before that judge, keeps begging and pleading for that job. So a job for our son.
God, in your grace.
I'm Julian. We have a good friend in Texas who broke her hip and has multiple health issues. Her name is Rita. So prayers for her strength and her recovery.
God, in your grace.
I'd like to ask for prayers for the 325 students that go to the elementary school next door to us that are identified as socially and economically challenged, the free and reduced students. I think sometimes we lose track of the numbers of people, but that's 325 students that attend the elementary school next door.
God, in your grace.
My name is Ernie, and I'd just like to have a show of hands of how many of us in this room today have been homeless at some time in our life. So we understand that it isn't just the person down the road. It's happened to some of us, and it could happen to some of you.
God, in your grace.
I pray for Janet at Cascade Middle School, where I was Friday.
She was not there. She had COVID as well. So prayer for healing for her.
God, in your grace.
You receive our prayers.
I would like to put a prayer in for Melvina. She has fallen twice. She messed up her right hip and her left ankle. She was getting on a city bus and she went to step and down she went. So she's in horrific pain. And also my second one is, I'm very blessed to be part of this Poor People's Campaign in Darcy. This organization is the best thing that's hit the United States of America.
God, in your grace.
And on the tail of what Ron was saying, there's always room for more angels back here, so feel free to sign up.
I just want to share with you, as you've already heard, I believe that Jennifer, our office assistant, has been sick this last week, which was very difficult. She had a significant episode that caused her to be completely fatigued and depleted, and she's recovering from that, hopes to be in this week, and we pray that's true. But just to let you know, she was scheduled to go to Arkansas. She had a trip planned, and she didn't know what she was going to do, but the flight was canceled because of weather. So she discovered that because of that, she's able to rebook the flight anytime up until December 24th. But we do want to pray for her healing and for her getting, this is a tough time and stress may be a part of it, because the annual report needs to get out. We're having changes to our bylaws shared, and we are doing two bulletins for memorial services coming up, and it's just a very demanding time. So we want to definitely pray for Jennifer. God, in your grace. Let us pray. Holy and gracious God, we do indeed lift our voices to you. We share the hurts, the sorrows, the struggles that we have gone through, that we may be even going through at this time. For those who are with us because of illness or disease, injury or harm, oppression, or struggle of mind, body, and soul. God, we lift them before you. We ask you to work a mighty work in their lives. We ask you to work a mighty work in our lives. We ask you to work a mighty work in this nation's lives and throughout the world. You hear us, O God. You respond to us, O God. We ask you once again, further those requests which are a part of your purpose, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen. Even as we heard the prayer cried out in Swahili, so we lift our voices again, sharing the prayer, our Lord's Prayer, as expressed by the Poor People's Campaign. I invite you to refer again to your bulletins. Let us pray. Our Liberator. Listen as I share, as we bring our offerings before God. You call us to help heal a world crying out for mercy and care. We bring these gifts and give ourselves to be your hands and feet. May we listen to your call and boldly share your transformative and radical love with all we meet. Let us bring our offerings to God.
There's a great trouble in the land. We're gonna set it right again. There's a great trouble in the land. We're gonna set it right again. There's a great trouble in the land. We're gonna set it right again. We're gonna set it right again. Trouble's been brewing too many years. We're gonna set it right again. Trouble's been brewing too many years. We're gonna set it right again. Trouble's been brewing too many years. We're gonna set it right again. We're gonna set it right again. People need healing all over the world. We're gonna set it right again. People need healing all over the world. We're gonna set it right again. People need healing all over the world. We're gonna set it right again. We're gonna set it right. Set it right again. We need clean water and healthy food. We're gonna set it right again. We need clean water and healthy food. We're gonna set it right again. We need clean water and healthy food. We're gonna set it right again. We're gonna set it right again. We must have housing, we've a right to thrive. We're gonna set it right again. We must have housing, we've a right to thrive. We're gonna set it right again. We must have housing, we've a right to thrive. We're gonna set it right again. Oh, we're gonna set it right again. There's a great trouble in the land. We're gonna set it right again. Oh, there's a great trouble in the land. We're gonna set it right again. There's a great trouble in the land. We're gonna set it right again. We're gonna set it right. Set it right again. We're gonna set it right. Set it right again. We're gonna set it right. Set it right again.
I invite you to refer back to your bulletins where we are asked to pray together these words of dedication for our offerings and for ourselves. Let us pray. We humbly
sending hymn is number 300. We are one in the spirit. Please rise and join in body or in spirit. Go out from this place energized, renewed, and strengthened by the bonds with each other and the Holy Spirit. Feel empowered to act radically and speak truth to power. Be the good in the world. Together we will move mountains and bring God's restorative justice to our community, both within and outside of these doors. May we move forward together and not one step back. We follow the light of Christ
and join it in shining our light into a world crying out for light and jubilee. We join together in unity to bind the wounds that need binding. We carry our light, joined as one to follow, and join with the light of Christ to shine in a world longing for light and for healing of the dark, of the brokenness. As we now exit sanctuary, following the light of Christ on the line, they marched with the torch. We're going to run with it now. We ask you to join hands with someone next to you and take one of the candles, and it's so powerful that we gather together and we join our lights, and now we take light into the world. Amen.
No, everybody else is just going to
How do you do?
Hi. Bright-eyed and bushy-tailed, we look here.
That was quite a sermon.
Yes, it was.